This is the second part of a presentation on outside pack reffing. The first part covered the history and basic positioning necessary to be able to work with two other outside pack refs in a regular rotation. This section, while still the basics, is a bit more advanced and covers other topics necessary to pull off being an OPR in an actual game. Since this is the second part of the outside pack ref presentation, I won't go over all the standard disclaimers. Just know that they still apply. This is me talking, not the WFTDA or MRDA. The date of this recording is July 25th, 2014, and there have been no updates since the original presentation was released. The disclaimers from the other outside pack ref module apply here as well. Even more so in this section, which goes into a lot of gray situations and areas that may well be taught differently by very good and very experienced outside pack refs. Remember, roller derby is a very young game, and this position is younger than the others and evolving at a faster pace. One of the biggest jobs of outside pack refs is to assist the jammer referees when the jammer heads to the outside. The reason behind this should be obvious. At the risk of making it sound like jammers are the most important people on the track, they are the focal point of the game since they're the only ones who can score points. Good blockers may be the key to jammer scoring, or defensively speaking, not scoring. But without jammers, it's just people skating in a circle aggressively, which is why outside pack refs give them special attention as they head to the outside. This section is very subjective. It's not the straightforward, this is the position you should be in mandate, because your positioning will vary on how readable the game is. While we'll have examples of typical situations, it may not apply to the game you're in. Perhaps because of common tactics used by one team that makes an illegal situation more or less likely. If there's a rule of thumb when it comes to any kind of positioning on the outside, it's be where you're most likely to be needed. If that's not the book position, so be it. However, that comes with the ability and experience to read the game. And if there's any doubt, use standard positioning. In this example, the gold jam ref has three people between himself and the jammer, who's also sitting on the outside line. Cuts to the outside, forearms, multiplayer blocks, just about everything is shielded from the referees on the inside, but not on the outside. In these situations, the outside pack ref becomes the primary person to determine any of those penalties on or by the jammer, and possibly if the jammer even scored any points. Let's take a look at this picture and add a few items for a scenario. First, note that all of the non-pivot blockers are numbered. We'll be referring back to them shortly. Second, the purple jammer is the lead jammer. And third, the gold jammer is on a scoring pass. This means she's already passed purple blocker number one. If the purple jammer calls off the jam, the gold jam ref is not in a position to see if her jammer has passed purple blocker number two or not. If the jammer has not already passed blocker number two and thus already earned that point, you may well be asked about it, which means you need to be in a position to see if the jammer has passed the hips of her opponents, which means being in roughly the same position as the jam ref, but on the outside of the track. Forgetting the scenario we just talked about, but staying with the pitcher, even if you know the jammer has passed all of the blockers, staying in position is crucial, not just for points, but in case the jammer gets knocked out of bounds and cuts an opponent, or if her opponent starts skating clockwise to draw a cut. This, of course, applies to blockers as well as jammers, but given the importance of power jams, getting a call incorrect on a jammer could have game-changing consequences and needs extra care. If purple blocker number two knocks the gold jammer out of bounds there, and there's no immediate cut, the top situation can become the one on the bottom almost immediately. Note that the purple blocker number one is trying to draw a cut even though the jammer was already in front of her. Again, the jam ref will probably not be able to see this. This is a call all on the outside pack ref. Here is an example of where you may need to drop out of position to aid the jam ref or to leave the jam ref. In this situation, you have both jammers at the extreme ends of the engagement zone. OPR 2 is staying with the jammer in the back, which is technically behind where she should be if she kept to a strict rotation. Meanwhile, OPR 3 is ignoring the jammer in the front and staying on the pack. The reason for both of these decisions has to do with the position of the jammer and the likelihood of something happening to the outside. In this case, because the gold jammer is walled up against the outside boundary line, having the OPR back up the jammer ref is crucial. On the other hand, the purple jammer is in the middle of the track, has both an inside pack ref and the corresponding jammer referee watching the play. OPR 3 isn't really ignoring the jammer, but instead keeping the jammer in her peripheral vision. And should the purple jammer find herself in a similar situation as gold, she will be ready to sprint up and assist the inside officials. Here we've taken a situation from the last diagram and modified it so that OPR 3 indeed does, and all things being equal, should move off the pack to help the purple jam ref. You may well ask if this scenario leaves the pack, who you can see is also to the outside of the track, without an outside pack ref to focus on those penalties. The answer is yes, and the reason is because the priority of focus goes to the jammers. Usually, this type of scenario doesn't stay like this for very long. All it takes is the purple jammer to go free, or a good hit by one of the gold blockers sending that jammer out of bounds, allowing the pack to catch up. Or, as the four blockers in the pack battle for superior position, they may bring the fore or aft blockers out of play, forcing the blockers at one end or another to disengage. The positioning by the jammers and being in position to see those jammers is also critical so you can pass on information to the jammer referees, such as no pass, no penalty with its associated hand signal, a penalty with its associated hand signal, or just no penalty, which doesn't have a hand signal. This has led some to ask, how do you communicate that a pass is legal and there's no penalty? The answer is first, to be in position, and second, establish eye contact with the jam ref, or at least look straight at the jam ref. The jam ref may have to focus elsewhere, but should, if you're in position, have you in his or her peripheral vision. Some like a very small nod for a good pass, or a head shake for no penalty. But essentially, whatever the communication needs to be, if you're not in the correct position, your communication may be missed, and because of that, an incorrect call may be made. In loud venues, when the referee isn't loud enough, or if a skater is just too focused, it's possible that a skater will not hear a penalty called by a referee. Referees on the inside have a shorter distance around the track and an easier time to be able to relay the call. Outside pack refs have the opposite problem. Should a skater miss a penalty you called, you have several options. By the way, this is in no particular order. Choose from this list based on what's going to work best in your situation. First, abandon your rotation to chase after the offending skater. This requires you to be willing and able to skate around the track and keep up with the penalized skater. This works better with penalized pack skaters, as they're normally going to be confined within the engagement zone. Be loud. Even if the skater can't hear it, your other outside pack refs will need to, because they'll need to pick up your slack and run full lap skating weights until you can resume a regular rotation. Second, relay the penalty to the next outside pack ref. Conversely, if you're the next outside pack ref, and you know you're faster than the last one, announce that you've got the penalty and do what needs to be done to enforce it. Third, attempt to communicate the penalty to an inside pack ref. Ideally, your penalty call should be as loud as your whistle and can happen simultaneously with the first two options. Fourth, if you cannot catch up with the offending skater and can't get the penalty relayed, stop chasing the skater, and instead go clockwise to meet the skater and possibly referees sooner. Finally, if all else fails, go inside and alert an inside pack ref. Since three of these options, possibly four, involve ditching your rotation, a quick primer on the two-man outside pack is probably in order, often referred to as the two-man skate and wait. As you can imagine, this means first, more and faster skating, and second, more diffused coverage. If we look at the same start-stop diagram from back at the basics of positioning, but take out one of the outside pack refs, things look much the same as with three, except now both outside pack refs stop at the same turn. As for which turn you stop on, just pick one. If an outside pack ref goes down mid-jam, yell out to each other, first to let your partner know that you're now going to have to cover an entire lap, and second to pick a stop. There doesn't need to be a discussion. If you started yelling, just say stop at turn two or stop at turn four. If you have to start a jam because you've gone down an outside pack ref or you're just short-staffed, you've got time to get together and brief yourselves. Next, go more conservative on your starts and stops since you'll have to cover more distance. If you're down to two because of an injury or because you're short-staffed, you could be doing this for the remainder of the game. Make sure you have the energy to complete it. Continue to start your runs at the green area, yellow if you need to, and if you need to stop in the yellow area to reset properly, do it. Don't stop in the red area unless the pack is really, really slow or stopped. If the pack is racing and there's no possible way to catch up or reset in time for the next lap, communicate with your other outside pack ref that you're stopping at the opposite turn. Yes, it could leave the pack uncovered, but for a shorter length of time than if you can never get back into proper position. Something to keep in mind if doing a two-man rotation is that you're still skating the longer distance around the track than the skaters, and can easily fall behind on the turns. Should the pack speed be such that this is a probability, then plan ahead and skate at the front of the pack, still keeping within it but far enough ahead that when you exit the turn, you're not so far behind as to be useless. Remember that there's still a straightaway ahead for you to cover. In this image, OPR1 has ended her run and is now heading back to turn 1. OPR2 is still watching the pack, but from a position further ahead as they enter turn 3 so as not to get caught behind when she has to skate faster than the pack to keep up. In this picture, we see the pack coming out of turn 4 and outside pack ref 2, by virtue of having to skate farther than the players, is falling to the back of the pack, but can cover it all through the straightaway until outside pack ref 1 picks it up. Now, if you can keep in the middle of the pack during the turn, by all means do so. But if the pack is going at a fast speed, this will help you stay in position to have outside coverage through the entirety of your run. So, what happens when we throw some engagements to the outside, such as jammers in this picture? There is no right answer. Pick a jammer based on where you think you can do the most good, which may be waiting to pick one up. Remember that it's far easier to slow down on a moving pack than it is to pick up lost distance, so it will be easier to hit the brakes to cover the jammer at the back, where outside pack ref 2 is, but you may end up sacrificing the rest of your run trying to catch up to the pack. If you can sprint ahead to get where outside pack ref 3 is, then you can later coast or slow down to the pack if the jammer leaves the engagement zone. The decision is one you'll have to make depending on your skating speed, the pack speed, your endurance, and if you can read the possible likely outcomes. For example, has the purple jammer been successfully skating through those walls successfully all game? If so, maybe take the back position, where there's a larger chance of you being required. I hope this presentation gives you a basic idea of some of the positioning challenges and solutions to being an outside pack referee. It cannot cover every situation. Otherwise, this would be a dull game to officiate, and at least in my opinion, it's anything but. And while at one point I suggested disregarding the stopping locations of outside pack refs at the WFTDA playoff level, I would also suggest you watch them to see where they position themselves for everything else. Watch what skating skills they're using, how they handle sudden changes in direction and pack speed, communication between all three during jams and between, the types of stops they're using, and so on. Just like players do, referees learn their skills, including positioning, through training, practice, and by the advice of their peers and more experienced officials. I hope this presentation gives you a baseline on what to do, and a better understanding of what is going on with outside pack reffing, and helps you do it even better. I'd like to thank CoreFan, Pre-Flash Gordon, Bob Krazek, and Doff Lensgren for permission to use their photographs in this module. I'd like to thank the Vienna Roller Derby for their permission to use their Ultimate Roller Derby Ubiquitous Magnet Board for this presentation. It can be found at viennarollerderby.org/URDUMB. If you found this presentation helpful, or think it or other presentations at refed.com might be helpful to others, please share this site. But please do not modify it or send it out without appropriate credit for its production. This presentation is licensed under the Creative Commons Attribution Non-Commercial No Derivatives 4.0 International License.